ever know that there was a German POW camp in Windsor during World War II?
No.
Oh, no, it's just, no.
Never heard about it.
No.
No. Do not know anything about the POW camp.
Did not know that.
No, not really.
No?
No.
No?
No.
No, I haven't heard anything about it. Yes.
No, I
haven't. Yes, we got a winner.
Oh, yeah, right up above us. It was quite a place. They had quite a few barracks up there. And they used to march them down the road down to Polish Market.
I heard about it at school.
I did. What an amazing part of American history. This little town that is now town green and awesome and part of the wine country was a very quiet area where we kept the German prisoners. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
They used them as workers, and they were kept safe and protected, and they just made them work. It was a safe area for them to be.
Yeah. The camp was right there, right up above us out there on the side of the hill up there. On the, I guess you'd say, the left side of the road.
I figured if they were going to keep them here, they may as well put them to work.
Served their purpose, and they had to have a place to stay, so that was it.
They were friendly. They were away from home. The environment was much safer and less hostile. And as you can tell, the weather here in Sonoma County is beautiful. So who wouldn't want to be here?
Yes, Sonoma County did house German prisoners of war in the town of Windsor, California. Mainly an agricultural, rural community with farmers, ranchers, and winemakers. Not too different from today. All of the young, healthy, able-bodied men had gone off to fight in World War II. So ironically, the German POWs were housed in Camp Windsor and commissioned out to help farmers, ranchers, and winemakers whose own young sons had gone off to fight in the war. The American severe labor shortage was alleviated by prisoner labor.
In 1944, Camp Beale housed in Camp Beale in Marysville housed the a lot of German prisoners of war, and Windsor was picked as a satellite camp. So the camp actually opened to German prisoners in August of 1944.
German soldiers were surrendering to the Allies in the hundreds of thousands. Hitler was losing the war, and with massive American reinforcements of men and supplies, it was more honorable to surrender than to retreat. Soldiers of all ages and nationalities had started to surrender to the Allies.
It was a migrant labor camp first that opened in 1939, and that was not without quite a lot of controversy. Nobody wanted the camp, or very few people wanted the camp locally. It was only open for about 18 months before it closed, and the government never relinquished ownership of it. So there were a series, after it closed in 1940, there was a series of requests to open it for different purposes. They wanted to reopen it as a migrant labor camp, and that was not recommended. They then suggested that it be open for the temporary relocation of enemy, or not enemy aliens, but Japanese citizens that were being relocated. And the government said that the camp was too close to sensitive areas, so it was not appropriate. They came from virtually all of the countries. But I think when Corporal Sullivan, Corporal when he was in the service, talked about the submariners that and the African Corps, they were genuinely German. That's where they came from. And it was later that the soldiers came from the other countries. And that was the only time I think he talked about kind of the horror of World War II, where Germans occupied a town, called everybody of a certain age together and told them that they were going to enlist. And if somebody said no, that they were shot. And that instance created a lot of volunteers. Nobody wanted to cross with that. And his friend told him that is when he was brought into the German military system, and finally sent out into combat, that his goal was simply to keep walking. He was just going to walk until he was captured and hope that he wasn't shot. And coming to America was, I mean, they viewed the Statue of Liberty just like immigrants. This is a great place to be.
It's amazing that so few American soldiers were supervising so many Germans. America could afford to house the Germans. The Germans had been brainwashed with propaganda into believing that America was in ruins, when in fact it was in full swing, in war mode, and the country was fueling the war. They expected to see the major cities of the U.S. in ruins, bombed and devastated.
Whether they all came in by train or if some came in by truck, I'm not certain. Al McCracken owned a store in town, and he remembered them coming into town on a train. What they did do, they did a lot of marching. They worked at the winery in Windsor, downtown Windsor. And so they would march from the camp to the winery. And so to and from, it's about just a little over a mile. They would very often sing, so they became very obvious marching down the street. They would be singing, and sometimes 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning on their way home or on their way down to the winery, singing at the top of their lungs. They also got quite a lot of attention that way. One of the guards told us how they, marching home, they would be singing particularly loud after their shift because they were given a certain ration of wine to have with their meal, which put them in great spirits, which made them sing even louder. And so there were complaints by the people that lived along the road to try to keep it down on the way back to the camp. The other good stories was, and Horst was not quite in that category, Horst Lewald, that we met, because he had been a good, he went into the service right out of high school. His father was already in the war in the Russian front, and so he knew that this is where he was going to go. And he had been indoctrinated almost entirely with the war rhetoric at the time. And the United States was kind of at the end of its rope. Our capacity for production of the materials needed to wage the war was running out. And when he came and got on the train in New York and started across the Midwest, he said that you could just feel the energy drain from the soldiers. They had absolutely no idea. And when they came to Chicago to see the size of the manufacturing capabilities and the size of the city of Chicago and the fact that there was no damage from the war, that this was a bustling city, they knew the war was over. And in fact, the war, by the time he got here, the war was only going to last another month or two before it was over. So that's, you know, that was an interesting take on it, that you're told one thing and then you discover another. Before the Windsor Historical Society, my wife and I were very involved in Windsor baseball. And we, in fact, were the founding members of Windsor Little League. And at that time, we were looking around for people to be sponsors. And we went to a friend who was a realtor. And we always hate begging for things. And so we tried to make it like a conversation. And the conversation was looking for a property. And he ended up showing us this property that we had absolutely no intention of buying or moving. And he explained that it was land that had recently come on the market and had been part of an old Camp Windsor. He described it as the prisoner of war camp. There were still some foundations around. We weren't interested, but we did take the drive with him. And then that kind of hooked us. And then we started finding out more about it. And when we actually thought that we could move, we knew we couldn't afford to build a house, so we moved our house from where we lived out to the property. So now we have kind of period correct house sitting on an old piece of property. We have a 1910 home very modest, sitting on a beautiful piece of property that used to house migrant laborers in the 30s and prisoners of war, German POWs in the 40s. I would love to be able to just walk out and find artifacts that had something to do with the camp. And those don't exist. We've never found dog tags or, you know, something that would associate it with the POW camp. We rebuilt our barn on the foundation of the community center that was part of the camp. And there were two buildings, or actually three buildings, that still exist today that are virtually unchanged. At least parts of them are virtually unchanged from when they were part of the camp. Because the camp was originally set up as the migrant labor camp, there were these. There was the base commander or the camp manager's house, and then there was a guard house where the PX was established. One of the guards that came to visit us joined the service in 1945 when he was 17 years old, and he looked, and by his own admission, he looked like he was 14 or 15, and he took pictures of the camp that that you were not supposed to take pictures of. It was against the regulations to take pictures of a camp. So he shared those with us, and we think they were probably the first pictures that we had ever seen, or anybody had ever seen, of Camp Windsor. So we would take those pictures and try to line up current scenes. And so we can see where they stood in front of the sign Camp Windsor, or in front of the flagpole, in front of the laundry room where the big sing-along occurred. And for us, it is a very moving experience living on it. I don't ever want to change anything. We were hoping we would find photographs of the building where our foundation was, and it's by pure luck we ended up building a barn that was not that different from the original building. But we have a neighbor whose addition to his house was built by the POWs, and we have a photograph of the carpenters with PW on each leg and PW on each arm, and they're looking at their handicraft, putting an addition on the building. And I'm guessing he's probably the only one in Sonoma County that has German POW inspired addition. The labor force was involved in fighting the war. And so the POWs, the idea was that they would be able to augment the lack of, or substitute for the lack of young men. And if you came to the camp with a need, they would authorize X number of POWs to go out to your farm to do a variety of things. They picked hops, they pruned the grapes, they pruned prunes, picked prunes. I think they did virtually everything that any farmer, any rancher would do. We've heard from very many people when the Germans came out of the camp, and again, almost to a person, they all describe these as the happiest, smilingest, nicest people that they ever wanted to have work on their farm. So it's a very unusual, I'm hoping unique, situation for the folks that lived in the area. The person that we got to talk to the most was Don Sullivan. And I was at work and my wife called and said that there was a gentleman at our house that said he had been at our camp, had been at the camp during the war, and could I come home? And I said, has he talked to the neighbors? Because I couldn't get home right away. And she said, well, he says he was a guard here during the war. And I said, I'll be home in 10 minutes. And Don was just 17 years old when he joined the service, so he looked like such a kid. He could have been my older brother to talk to him. He was out here with his son, and he had just a great time visiting. He had a little bit of a hard time getting himself oriented to the camp, told us some just fabulous stories. He left his gun on his cot one day while he was out, and the POWs would go in and clean up the tent. And he came back and his gun was cleaned, and there was a note along with it that suggested that perhaps he shouldn't leave that out, that he might get in trouble. And one of the POWs had given him that note. He told the stories about taking his friend, Tommy Coletta, down to the movies in Santa Rosa. He'd put a coat on him and they'd drive down to see the movies. He told a great story of the guards all being particularly happy because the prisoners had done a good job and were being recognized for a good harvest, a good day of pruning, something that they had done. So the guards bought them a bunch of beer, and they had put it in buckets and laid it out on the cement pad in ice. And then they stood back as the Germans filed into the camp and were astonished to watch the POWs walk up to the beer, tip it over, let all the ice and water out, and then lay all the beer flat on the cement to warm it up, because they would never drink cold beer. They thought that was unbelievable, and the Americans were surprised to watch them drink warm beer, but that's how it was. So he had all these great little snippets of his memories. They drive the large trucks down to the Presidio to pick up coal to bring it back. He gave us a photograph of the guards staring at the Golden Gate Bridge from Sausalito as they were picking it up. So it was a great visit. We've corresponded with him for almost 10 years, lost touch with him about 5 years ago. Not exactly sure what happened, but well, we know he moved. But he provided us with a lot of fun photographs and stories.
Now, Männer. Alles klar? Auf Manöverstation.
I guess they were sailors. And they escaped, and by the time they were caught in Point Reyes, I think that's as far as they got, that's what they had wanted to see, the Pacific. They had spent their military career on the Atlantic, and as sailors, they knew the Pacific was right there, was right out their back door, and they just wanted to see it. It created a little hysteria as people were looking for them and whatnot, but they just wanted to get back. They were like, it reminds me of like kids that run away from home and then all they want to do is figure out how to get back home without getting into trouble. And I think that was the case. Don Sullivan talked about POWs that had been out doing something, you know, just taking a walk, and then oops, they came back and the place was locked down and they had to figure out how to get in without getting into trouble, because it was dangerous. If you were caught outside, that might create a problem. And
Press Democrat, Wednesday, September 20th, 1944. Escaped Nazis recaptured. Two fleeing prisoners of war nabbed. Coast Guard patrol seizes fugitives at Dillon's. forced out of hiding along the Marin coast by hunger. Two escaped German prisoners of war, who fled from Camp Windsor during the early morning hours last Friday, were captured by a Coast Guard patrol yesterday morning. The pair, identified as Frederick Sternberg, 21, and Otto Stern, 21, were picked up by Coast Guardsmen from the Bodega Bay Station shortly after Sternberg had appeared at the Tom Larson home at Dillon's Beach and in broken English had asked for food or something to do. Stern remained in the background while Larson was approached by his companion. Larson, former member of a submarine crew in World War I, became suspicious of the pair and after turning down their request notified a Coast Guard patrol. Lieutenant Guy King, commander at Bodega Bay, was notified and he dispatched a patrol to the Dillon's Beach area. Boatswain's mate 1C Thomas Campion, former Santa Rosa police officer, and carpenter's mate Kenneth Jensen, also of Santa Rosa, were in the patrol that apprehended the two German fugitives. An FBI special agent and chief criminal deputy, William E. Cook Jr. of the sheriff's office, also sped to the beach, arriving just after the prisoners had been loaded into a Coast Guard truck. Cook, Campion, and Jensen, and the FBI agent, brought the prisoners to the county jail, where they were given their first meal in several days. Both men said they had only a loaf of bread between them for rations since their flight Friday morning. After questioning by the officers, both were booked and locked up, pending arrival of Army authorities who will return them to Camp Beale at Marysville for detention. Both prisoners told officers that curiosity and not a desire to escape had caused them to flee from the Windsor camp. Both, they said, were former German Navy men and had seen service only on the Atlantic.
We wanted to also see the Pacific Ocean. We knew it was close by and we thought we could make this trip in 2 days. We took a loaf of bread and started out, but got into the hills and it was further than we thought. Sunday morning we saw the ocean and went down to the beach and took a swim. We traveled only at night and hid most of the time in the daytime. Finally, we figured we couldn't get back to camp, so we went to the ranch and asked for something to eat or a job. We figured the man would tell on us, so we kept close to the road so they could see us.
Army officers from Camp Beale arrived here last night, but the men were not released, pending further questioning and investigation of their escape and actions since they left the camp at Windsor.
When the war was over, the POWs went back home to Europe. They didn't know what they would find. They had left an idyllic place, a place where they had food, shelter, and a purpose to their lives, to a Europe with food shortages and an uncertain future.
This immigration to Windsor, we had one where we had destitute families coming as the migrant labor camp, and then we had people coming essentially under guard to the camp that were combatants. And in some stories, the people that were here that were destitute were not welcomed, while the people we were actually fighting were welcomed. So there's just an interesting lessons in life to be learned, I think, just constantly. Every story that we hear makes you kind of pause and ponder what the psychology of the whole event, the whole, we haven't experienced the whole nation at war, or the whole nation in that kind of depression. So there's things that we learn all the time, and it's never ending. The story's never ending, and I think that's the most interesting part of it for us.